Burke's Perspectives on BCTV is supported in part by a friend of BCTV.
I think I'm the friend.
Hello, welcome once more. We're Burke's Perspectives, and we can't tell you how happy we are that you're joining us. I'm Fred Levering. We have most of the crew today. Starting over yonder, we have Ruth Martelli, Fred Opalinski, Martha Richardson. You may have guessed by now that John Forrester is not with us today, but is on the sick list. So hopefully it's not the famous coronavirus.
Oh, get well, John.
But he texted me or emailed me to say that he didn't want to infect anybody. So he was very
gracious of him.
Good thinking. And I don't think he can get it over the TV anyhow, but nevertheless. So speaking of the virus, what do you think? We had government response in motion yesterday, arguing, of course, as usual, as to what the appropriate amount of dollars ought to be spent on it are, which I have to say, I thought the president answered well, saying, isn't this about health and not about partisan bickering, which I was glad to hear him say. But nevertheless, what are your thoughts here? I mean, is this... This whole thing, have you been thinking about it much?
Insofar as tens of thousands of people have died from the flu, you know, and by comparison, this is a small thing, but it's got the potential for growing, of course, because there is no cure for it. There is some treatment. But and in spite of what the president says, we're nowhere near having
zero.
The vaccine developed.
Nor near zero. I mean, he said we're going to be at zero. Well, no, the cases are just growing.
I wish we had been better prepared. It just seems to me that knowing that pandemics have a good chance of happening, that there would be more things in place to deal with it. And I guess that was sort of ideological on my part.
Well, there are vacancies in any number of health-related positions in the government
because
the president has gotten rid of folks and not replaced them.
The arm of the CDC that's charged with preparing for pandemics has pretty much been eradicated.
And so even locally, you know, what have we prepared? I haven't heard anything from the Red Cross. Are schools prepared? I have my daughter's best friend is a school nurse. I think she must be going crazy trying to figure out how to coordinate because she's head of the nurses in her district, and it must be very difficult. But
there's lots of other ramifications. I mean, the stock market was taking a pretty good licking earlier
today.
It seems to have come back a little bit
that's the third day it's really
over the week. This is the worst dive since the 2008 thing. There is an effect there. Now, I understand that some of the factories in China they're now getting people back to work. So they seem to think they've made some degree of progress,
I guess. South Korea, which has been particularly hard hit, has seen its numbers increase because now they're testing for it.
And that's where people are complaining about Italy, because they're testing too much.
Is that right?
But how can you test that much?
Here, I think we're not testing at all.
We're not testing at all.
Well, they are at you know, people that come in from out of the country are being screened at the airports. Mm.
But then it happened last week because I think we mentioned it on that show. The government, our government, allowed 42 Americans to leave, I think, China.
Yeah.
No, the ship that had been quarantined in Japan.
Right.
And against advice of the medical community, put those 42 infected people on a plane with people who weren't infected.
Mm.
So because planes recirculate the air, anybody who's sneezing and those respiratory drips are spread throughout the plane, then, you know, it's a crapshoot whether or not the rest of the people are going to get ill.
Well, I heard a doctor interviewed, and one of the questions to her was, should people be wearing those masks? And she said, no. She said, healthcare professionals should when they're treating folks who have it. But otherwise, the very most important thing you can do is wash your hands.
And not shake hands.
Yes.
Yeah.
Go on Amazon and look for masks and watch how they're jacking up the prices. Not the price of the mask, but the shipping. And you can get 50 masks for $50, but then shipping and handling may very well be $250.
Why?
Just, I have no idea.
But somebody noticed because at the
they're all made part in of Korea or China or Japan. I don't know if I want masks. Well,
I was listening to somebody who's a specialist with pandemics, an epidemiologist, and he said that the kind of face mask you want for protection is the kind that health care workers utilize, but they can't be worn the way people are being shown on the streets of Tokyo. We can't handle that kind of mask for a long period of time, and those are the only masks that are really effective. And that's why healthcare professionals have to have them.
So what is the difference as to how you wear it?
I don't know. I would imagine that it can strain out even more contaminants.
Well, I read also that the masks that they're selling and that people are wearing are really only good for infected people. They will keep the infection from going through the mask outward. But if you're wearing them to protect yourself from, get my hands down, from germs coming in, from the virus coming into the mask, it's not going to work.
But this is one
wash
of those,
your hands a lot.
This is one of those fine lines, I think, in terms of how we deal with it as a country, to have people on the alert without going to the point of panicking. Yeah. And because there will be people that will go to the extreme, for sure. And so it's not an easy thing.
No, but what we have to hope is that the people who are now in charge,
like Vice President Pence.
Well, he's delegated somebody else because he doesn't have the expertise that's needed in his role as governor.
He's more like a quarterback kind of just carrying out.
He's supposed to, but I'm speaking specifically of the president. You cannot afford to have somebody in his position prevaricate about what's going on. Fred's exactly right. You don't want people panicking, but you don't want people to ignore washing their hands, refraining from, you know, hand touching and holding, what have you. But you have to be honest. And to say on a national broadcast that soon we'll be at zero and that we're doing everything we possibly can, it's not true.
Well, but he really did say very clearly about washing hands and,
But he's also not telling the truth, Fred.
And when he said that we're close, I mean, this is what he said in India when asked about it. He said, well, we're close to having a
cure,
a vaccination or a immunization, which is just not, we're at least a year from that.
Yes.
And I think that he realized the stock market could be shaky because that was before Monday's downturn. I call me cynical. But I have to think that he got excited about this when the stock market fell on Monday.
Oh, indeed.
Because he was just sort of blowing it away. You know, we've got it under, you know, I've got it under control.
Well, I think there is an effort to not, you know, throw a gallon of gasoline on a fire either, as, you know, trying to, you know, people panicking, they overreact.
Right.
There is something to be said for that. And I think that he's, when he talks about a vaccination being around the corner or whatever, I mean, we actually, from what I saw, a medical guy on TV last night who said that, yeah, we have
on
developed
Fox.
Something, but now it's got to go through this trial and that trial and this trial.
Right, so
therefore, it won't be available for a year. But they do actually have something now that they think seems to be effective.
But that's the same thing as with the flu. I had my flu shot.
Right.
Lots of people had their flu shots. Lots of people didn't. And some people get the flu and some people don't.
And they have been telling people to get the flu shot.
But this year is particularly hard hit children.
Right.
And there have been more children dying from the flu this year than I guess there have been in a long time.
And actually, there have been two different flus. And I guess the jury's still out as to whether that flu shot is good for the second one.
Well, and depending on your age, you get, I got the most,
the senior
shot.
The hyper shot.
Everything today seems to be in the context of politics. And one of the things that I thought about a little bit was if the upcoming presidential election continues as it appears to be, that it might end up being Donald Trump and Bernie Sanders, and Sanders is talking loudly about free health care and Medicare for all and all that stuff, and then it is an outbreak of this thing, will that benefit Bernie Sanders from the standpoint of people saying, oh, free health care, free medicine, I've got the flu, this virus thing, that sounds good to me. And could it be a tipping point in an election?
Who knows what the results of something, if it were truly to become a pandemic here, who knows where that would take us.
I'm sure there are people that would feel that way, but I don't think it would be a significant, I don't think it would make a significant difference.
I was listening to somebody last night who said for every one infected person, that person will infect two or three other people. Then you have those two or three other people infecting two or three other people. So we have no idea how far this is going to go. But we
don't know how it's being spread either.
And in Northern California, they just found the first patient with no, they can't trace it back to anybody who had anything to do with China. But I just would hope, Fred, that the president won't downplay the severity of the disease because he doesn't want the stock market to tank, because that's what he's pinning his hopes on for re-election.
And he's got a very, very important role now to balance that between alertness and creating panic. I think that would be a very difficult role for anyone.
Well, and my big concern about that with him is that he is so imprecise a speaker, and unless he is scripted, he'll go all over the place depending upon what he thinks will best benefit him.
And
we can't. We need somebody who is trustworthy and who is saying things that are accurate and truthful.
All right. Well, we can revisit, and this is going to be an ongoing topic. But now, thinking about what you just said,
you don't know if we'll all be here next time.
Well,
may I just say, though,
I guess I'm with Donald Trump or something. I will be here, come hell or high.
Not if you're ill, don't come here.
One word about the stock exchange. I just read that one stock that is going up, Campbell's Soup.
True. Well, isn't that interesting? The chicken soup, and probably chicken soup.
No doubt about that. It's been stripped off the shelves.
Right,
Now, you mentioned about leadership. Now, and the steady hand kind of thing. Did you watch the Democratic debate the other night, and did you see anything there that made you feel like some leadership being shown?
They
were yelling at each other and stepping on each other. Mm-hmm. And
I thought it was a disaster, but I thought the moderators did the worst job I have seen on any of the
debates. They really seemed in over their head. I mean,
absolutely. There was no depth to what they were doing.
It is the most stupid way to choose a leader, because you force people who otherwise might tend to be modest and pretty polite, and you put them in a position where they score points by being terrible.
They stand out some way.
We were talking about this last night at dinner with our son. I said, it's like watching the gladiators.
Yeah.
And that's not how you choose a leader. And I've said before on this show, and I'm going to say it again because I find it appalling, the amount of money that's been raised and spent by the president and his reelection committee, and also the people on the stage. Mm-hmm. Because forget telling children that anybody can grow up and be president, not the way it is now. You can't.
Let's explore that a little bit. We've talked about elections in general, and this one, of course, specifically, but sometimes I wonder whether the primaries, as we have them now, are the best way to choose a leader. I'm saying is, I know that the founders, if you've read the founders' stuff, had a lot of skepticism about political parties. And then, it reared its head as early as the third election with Thomas Jefferson and John Adams, who was at that point incumbent. And it's been that way now ever since. We've always seen the move to your base in the primaries to get nominated, and then a move toward the center in general elections for the most part. And some of the stuff being discussed is hard to imagine is going to be central to the general election. But is this the best way to do it? Or I think sometimes about some of the European systems have kind of an open sort of primary, and whoever the top two vote getters then run off in a general.
But it does, they don't go on
and it may be two of the same party or something.
Much shorter period of time.
They have a much shorter, 4 months.
I wish John was with us, given his background in knowing about, you know, a lot of
I think this is much too protracted. I mean,
but boy, I'll tell you, I really worry about it.
Donald Trump started running for re-election the day of his inauguration.
Yeah. And that's why he has all those stupid fund, I don't know what you call it.
But that has happened in every level. I mean, I have been friends with several of our local congressmen that I've gotten to know through my political adventures or whatever. And
they spend most of their time working for the election.
They had one guy told me he had a raise on average about $10,000 a week. That's the way it was.
Toward this is for a local position, right?
No, this was a congressional thing.
But that's what that's what Citizen United has done to us. When there was McCain-Feingold, dark money was out of the out of the system. You could not be a corporation and funnel money into a campaign or into a PAC. And all those safeguards are no longer in place. And people and corporations can make gifts of astonishing amounts. Those people, some of the people, families of the people who were given, well, you said it was clemency or whatever you want to call it, by the president.
Commuted.
They had their sentences commuted after the families of those people had contributed to the re-election campaign. Right. Now, if that's not conflict of interest and an ethical violation, what is? And how can a president of the United States, in tweets, attack somebody on a jury and claim all kinds of awful things about this foreperson, to the point where whoever that guy, Roger Stone, is appealing to the court for a brand new trial because the president, who doesn't even know this woman or have any basis for his comments, is prejudiced. How many people are going to say, you know what, I really don't, in good conscience, I can't serve on a jury because I'll be attacked? And people have made death threats against these people. How do you... condemn this?
Have you, I assume you've been at some point been on a local jury in Berks County?
Yeah.
I mean, they ask a lot of questions about what your connections might be and so on and so forth. And this lady was apparently all over Facebook complaining about President Trump and so on and so forth, and yet was allowed to be on that jury.
What are your sources?
I've heard, commentary on various news shows of different, you already know that I, generally watch Fox, but I read a lot of different things as well, and they said that this person really shouldn't have been put on that jury.
But then you need to read the post where a person who was on the jury denied all those allegations about that woman and said that the things that are being said about her were not true.
Well, I don't know whether or not she espoused those views in the jury room,
but still,
she certainly
did it prior to
getting...
The President of the United States has no business bringing that kind of one-sided slander against the system.
For 4 years. And getting back to what your original question was about the primaries, and I agree with that. This is a weird... This is like playing at games. How do we change that? I can't imagine how it could ever change.
Thank you. Segway, we concluded our program last week with some discussion about the Constitution and whether it is fixed and, originalists and versus a living constitution.
Living doctrine.
That's about where we ended, and I even jotted it down so I wouldn't forget where we ended. And this is, I think, part of that. The Constitution, I think, is what it is, but it can be amended. And there's a process for doing that, as opposed to having some judges decide that they know better and doing it on their own, which is what has happened.
You're a strict constructionist.
But it can be changed.
You didn't let me say what I wanted to say. So if you're a strict constructionist or an originalist, are you talking about the Constitution and the first 10 amendments?
No,
or
the Constitution.
As it exists with Roe versus Wade being decided and now
Well, that's that actually,
law.
Because it was a bunch of justices that made that decision as opposed to it having come through the legislative process, I think it is to a degree an open question. Now, there are people that feel that a number of years, enough years have gone by that it becomes settled law as they refer to it. I'm not a jurist, so I can't really weigh in very effectively on that particular argument. But it does highlight exactly my point that it was done not through legislation, but through that. There are ways to change the Constitution, and the fact that you mentioned the first 10 amendments, the Bill of Rights, is there it is. Well, they amended the Constitution. Well, there was a process to do it, and it's happened many times since.
That was because some of the people who were involved in the Constitutional Convention were not satisfied that the Constitution as it was written would protect those particular rights of the people. And so they adopted those in a short period of time after the document was accepted.
And they did an amazing job. But I think it seems to me to be naive to think that in spite of how wise those founding fathers were, the writers of the Constitution, considering how things have changed so dramatically in every area of our life.
There would be no way they could have anticipated that.
They could have possibly anticipated that, and that they could have written something so magnificent that it would have covered all those changes.
I couldn't agree.
And eventualities.
I couldn't agree more.
And I'm sure you
could. But if you're going to change it, then change
go through
it
the
exactly.
rules,
as opposed to just deciding we don't like that anymore.
Well, but then you have to guarantee that there's a mechanism that a particular group can refuse, like the Equal Rights Amendment. What, 32 states accepted it, and then some people said, no, we're not, and wouldn't even hold any kind of vote on it within the state. So how can you change the Constitution if you have people who won't bring it to a vote?
The founders made the system complicated on purpose so that it couldn't just be changed on a whim or whatever, or one individual become overpowering or whatever. So what you have is you elect people to your state legislature that agree with your point of view, and then they propose something that gets proposed on up the ladder, and eventually it can be on the ballot and become an amendment to the Constitution. There's a methodology here,
but
and that's
you know
all
that
I want
there are
is
people
to follow
who,
the rules.
Who can blast those things out of the water, who they never get to be voted on. Do you think if it was left to the states to ratify the Constitution, to end slavery, to bring about civil rights, do you think that would have been done if it had been left to individual states' legislatures?
Yes.
In Alabama and Mississippi and Louisiana and South Carolina and Florida? I don't think so.
But the union, is the whole presumption is that you have the majority rule through the union. So, I don't know, maybe one state or two states or whatever, five of them, wouldn't agree. But as long as the other, whatever the number was at that time, 40 or so, the other 35 agreed, tough luck, we're changing it. I mean, there's votes. That's no different than any other election.
But getting back to your question or concern about court decisions, because the Constitution can't anticipate every nuance of every question that arises, the job of the court is to interpret that. I mean, so that is always going to be a living and changing expression. So it's not as though the courts are taking the place of the Constitution, but their role is to interpret a specific issue that isn't by jot and tittle taken care of in the Constitution
I
itself.
I don't necessarily agree with that. Yeah. I mean, the purpose of the court is to take a look at legislation and say, is it constitutional? If it's not, then you need to change the Constitution, which can be done. I'm not saying it isn't complicated. It is. It was supposed to be. But it can be done.
But it's not as though the Founding Fathers said, here's this document, we're tying your hands behind your back and making it so rigorous to change things. And the other thing that originalists, I think, forget about or don't state is the document as written limited itself to only the interests of white men of property. Now, somewhere along the line, you've got to admit that that's changed.
It
but
has.
It took until the 1920s to get women the right to vote, and until the 1960s and 70s to get blacks the right to vote without having to prove they could read or write or pay a tax.
But it was changed. You got to recognize that the system was, in essence, the idea of diversity from the very beginning, where you had people that came here from England, from Spain, from Portugal, from the Netherlands, a lot of different places. And the power is from the people up to the government instead of the other way around. Up to that point, every government in the history of the world was some sort of an authoritarian thing, you know, whether it was an emperor or a king or whomever, that was either passing down the power from one to another or were murdered and somebody else decided they were going to be in charge. I mean, this is the first time it happened this way. And what that means is that you now have this power coming from the bottom, and you have to get consensus amongst people. We all have discussed here before about how difficult it was to get the Constitution even ratified in the first place because of the difference of opinion between the North and essentially the South.
And
it took us 75 years, but they got it right then.
But they had to kill one another to do it.
Well,
but to make
nobody
that work,
it's going to be easy. I mean,
no, but you can't.
But you have to have a very vital citizenry who is taking an active part. I think we've become very lazy as a citizenry, because said, we've elected you, you're in for life, just go do
voter
your thing.
I was just going to say, voter turnout is the primary.
We don't even get out to vote. So if it's not working, it's because of the people who are supposed to work from the bottom
and
up.
And we got teachers on this panel here that we've talked before about the importance of civics.
Absolutely.
I mean, I read an interview with the governor of Florida who wants to institute a civics actual exam, you know, and he thinks that it would probably be best when they're about 18 or so, because now you're eligible to vote, and they got to know some of this
but
stuff.
But who's
going to
make the test? And what's the right answer? And is it absolutely going to be apolitical? Is it historical?
Well, I don't have to go talk to the guy in Florida.
No,
I don't know, but
that's...
That is important. Yeah.
Of course it's important. Yeah. You can't just say, let's give us a test.
We've been kicked off the air again. So, thanks for joining
us.
We're
going to pick this up.
This will be continued. We'll have John back next time, and that will make it even more complicated. Thanks.
Burke's Perspectives on BCTV is supported in part by a friend of BCTV.